To that musical interlude. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Great. Thank you so much for joining us. Perhaps others will tune in. We will be re-recording. I've started that already. And I am so happy to present Bob Cronin. I've seen this presentation and it's really, really helpful. You'll be amazed what you can do to self-edit before you turn your copy over to your editor. And most public radio stations do not have the luxury of having a copy editor. So he does work for St. Louis Public Radio on a part-time basis after a long career as an editor. And he works with them pretty much every day, right, Bob? You usually have something that you edit. And yep. We're actually gonna start availing ourselves of his skills for the Midwest Newsroom on a project basis. So I'm really excited about that. And without further ado, I want to just welcome everybody to this training. We're really excited to have some folks from Ozarks Public Radio. You want to wave and introduce yourselves?
Oh, cool.
Like if I can find the unmute button. I have my younger colleague, Megan McKinney, with me today. We are just feeling like this is a great opportunity to skill up. I spend a lot of time fixing proofreading stuff. And so just want to share, you know, what.
And since we're a small group, why don't we just introduce ourselves? Gabe, we'll start with you.
Holly, you ambushed me. Hello, I'm Gabe Rosenberg. I'm the audience editor at KCUR. I deal a lot with podcasts and everything digital and social media.
And we have Sarah Lawler. Sarah, we can't hear you. Try again. Oh, can't hear you. Put your name in the, put your description in the chat. And we have Elizabeth Rembert.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth. I'm the Harvest editor based in Nebraska, or Harvest reporter based.
Did you just give yourself a promotion? nice to see you. Michael Leland.
Hi, Michael Leland. I'm the news director of Iowa Public Radio in Des Moines. And odd for a summer Friday, but just about all of my reporters who are working today are covering things right now. So they will watch the replay.
That's okay. Sarah tells us she is a student reporter at Nebraska Public Media. So that is Sarah. Let's go to Laura.
Hi,
Sorry about that. I'm Laura Ziegler. I'm a longtime audio reporter and producer and relatively new to the digital. I mean, we've been doing it for a long time, but so I'm always interested in improving my digital skills. I'm the community engagement editor and reporter at KCUR.
Aaron.
Hi, I'm Aaron Bonderson. I'm a Report for America reporter in the Nebraska Public Media newsroom. And so I do radio and web reporting.
Thank you. CJ.
Hi, everyone. I'm CJ Janovy, content director at KCUR.
And I see on my screen below you is Mike Tobias.
Non-news, TV, radio, digital producer at Nebraska Public Media.
Cool. And then next to you on my screen, conveniently, is Daniel.
I'm a data reporter from Midwest Newsroom based at Nebraska Media in Lincoln, Nebraska.
Mm-hmm. And Luke?
That's me. I'm a culture editor at KCUR, former reporter before that, former talk show producer before that, and washed windows before that.
You're multi-skilled. Lawrence Brooks.
Hello, I'm Lawrence Brooks. I'm the race and culture reporter over here at KCUR 89.3. Nice to meet everybody.
And if you have some leisure time, you should go over to KCUI.org and read his awesome story about an Eritrean soccer team. So that's pretty cool. Clay. We're not hearing you, Clay. But that's Clay Masters of IPR, podcaster, host, announcer, reporter, et cetera. And then someone new who I don't know, Serene or Cyrene?
Yes, it's Serene. I'm from Nebraska Public Media.
Nice to see you. I'm going to hand it over to Bob. And Bob, you want to share your screen and then introduce yourself a little bit?
Sure. It sounds like we got Nebraska covered. That's excellent. I've been mostly an editor all over the place for a long time, including Detroit Free Press, Washington Post. I was assistant professor at Mizzou. I'm in St. Louis as we speak, as I think Holly said. My teaching background means I can be insufferable. So just, feel free to disagree or question. As an example, before this is out, we'll be discussing Winston Churchill. That's what I mean by insufferable. But anyway, feel free to speak out. Up, out.
All right. I'm a Mizzou student.
What's that, Serene?
I said I'm a Mizzou student.
Oh, great.
MIZ.
Oh, excellent. Awesome. Excellent.
All right, so I think we are ready for you, Bob. I'm not sure what we're looking at.
Do you see today's topics?
I see something that says, it looks like your files, not your actual.
Oh, well, I clicked on one. Let me try it again.
There it is.
All right, excellent.
I'm not seeing it yet. You clicked on it, but it didn't open.
Really?
Try again.
Okay, let me close and start over.
While Bob is doing that, I will tell you that our next training in July is going to be with none other than the former voice of NPR, as I call her, Jessica Hansen. She's the person who used to say, NPR is funded by the Schmidt Family Foundation, in that beautiful voice. So she's going to do a great training that anybody can use to help with your radio voicing, especially if you're new to radio or feel like you need a little help. So that's going to be great. And she charges a lot of money normally. So this is like value for free. And I will share those dates out with everybody, of course, as usual.
It tells me I'm screen sharing. Do you not see it?
Again, I'm seeing your like your menu, but not the actual PowerPoint like you had it up before.
I'd like to assure everybody that Holly and I tested this before you came on. It was just wonderful. It was a
yeah. If you want to share, if you want to email it to me, I can try it from my end, but I don't know why it's not working.
Yeah. I've got two versions there. Let me if this doesn't work, I'll email it to you.
We'll edit this out of the file.
Yeah. That's not it?
Yes, we have it.
You have it. Excellent. All right. Now you see today's topics. Okay. So I'm hoping you get the joke there, or you will before it's over. These first couple, I'm not sure how relevant they are to you. I did it for our crew because we use a lot of this, and it's just something little thing that needs to be standardized to give us that professional look. When we say when something's going to happen, we list events or whatever, and that's you just have to remember time, date, place. That's how we do it: time, date, place. So we do not say it's going to be in Columbia on June 14th at 3 p.m. It's time, date, place, and this is such a basic that's so important that the Mizzou faculty at one point decided everyone who graduated, no matter what they were going to do, needed to learn how to do these time, date, place. So here are all the different ways we do them. And see, time, 7 p.m., Thursday, Enterprise Center. And is we, the one of the sort of the basic principles to these is that if you're talking about something within the next week and you want to use the day, you just say it's Wednesday. It'll be Wednesday at Enterprise. If it's the second Wednesday from now, then you use the date. And that applies for a month also. You say something's going to happen in October because that's the first, this October is the first one we have coming up. If it's going to be October 2024, you have to use the 2024. And some of this is just, and the principle, this is true for dates, time, date, place, and addresses also. The more specific you get, the more likely you are to use abbreviations. So if you just say it's like Thursday, and that's all you say, yeah, okay, or it's in September 2024, you spell out September. But if you start using the date, the number, September 13th, you abbreviate September. And that's true for the next page for also. And some of it is just, you're not going to remember all this, but you know, Holly will have these cheat sheets. Some of it is just, if you look at the bottom line, that Friday, May 19th, 9 p.m. to 1 p.m., that actually came in on a story. So some of it is just to recognize that whatever you think the style is, or however you think you're supposed to do these, you recognize that it's not that way. You know, that can't be right. Friday, May 19th. I told somebody that's a note on the fridge. That's not a professional publication style. And so this is true for addresses too. The more specific you get, the more likely you are to use abbreviations like Olive Street when you say the address. If you just say something's on North Grand Boulevard, all those are spelled out. If you're using the numbered address, you start abbreviating everything that can be abbreviated. And the bottom one is just kind of a reminder that you can say, it's a little out of style. You used to use it all the time because newspapers especially would not necessarily use addresses for everything. It would just sort of say where something is. So if you say the Esquire's, does anybody know what the Esquire is? You do, excellent. And that is right where it is. Clayton Road and Big Bend. You don't need to say near the intersection of, just near Clayton and Big Bend. So that's something we don't need to spend a lot of time on. As I said, you'll have a cheat sheet. That's, you know, I don't know how much this applies anyway. But this, now we're getting to, this is pronoun confusion. This is in my personal professional opinion, the biggest problem facing us today. You probably thought it was truth or facts, disputes. It's actually pronoun confusion. So if you look at the top sentence, Centene said they might move away. So like right after the session, if you see a sentence like that, it'll immediately occur to you, wait, Centene isn't a they. A company can't be a they, so something's wrong. But if you look at the second sentence and the third sentence, it gets real, is the pronoun needs an antecedent. The antecedent is Centene. So if they get farther apart from each other, it gets tougher to tell what the antecedent is. You've got a whole bunch of words in between. Like that bottom one, it's the same pronoun and the same antecedent, but you got to get through a whole lot of junk, and that is not a real sentence, that, by the way, a whole lot of junk that makes it murkier, less easy to figure what the antecedent, what the pronoun should be for that antecedent, or what the antecedent is for the pronoun. Does anybody know how to diagram sentences? No?
I always wished I'd learned.
Yeah. I had a grad student come in once, tell me what she wanted to get out of a class I was teaching. She said, I want to learn how to diagram sentences. Said, you know, you're in the wrong class, because I cannot do that. I know I had it in grade school.
What is the benefit of diagramming a sentence?
Well, we'll show you. But
Before we move on, I wanted to go back to the pronoun confusion. Wouldn't Centene be an it, not a they, or is that a whole other can of worms?
No, it would be an it. And okay. And that's what the problem is in these sentences.
Okay. But,
well, we're not finished with the Centene example.
Okay.
So the advantage of diagramming a sentence is you one is you avoid problems like this. You can more easily see what aligns. You know, I don't actually refer to any of this stuff as grammar, by the way. I'm not a grammar expert. It's syntax. These words, the writing has to track. Otherwise, it's what a guy I worked with used to call that, you know what we mean writing. And that's what it is when we say, you know, Centene, they might move away. Well, they is wrong, but very often we publish it with they, and readers have to kind of figure it out. I just read a project that was excellent in every way, but man, every other paragraph had this sort of problem. The only pronoun used in it was they, and it was used incorrectly to refer to the city, to organizations, nonprofits, you know, the Senate, the council, you know, none of which are they. And you get into sentences where, as we're about to, where it gets really tough for the reader to decipher, tough for the editors to decipher. So the advantage is, this is beyond me, but the way I think of it, I do it a simpler way in my head that I recommend. And that is, the only thing I remember from diagramming sentences is, you see this after the breakup, that's a prepositional clause. So you pull that out, you can do it just mentally. Pull that out of the sentence. And if you pull it out, like if you look at the Centene example, if you pull out all that stuff between Centene and said, it gets easier to make the sentence track, to make it follow. It's sort of an easy way to mentally diagram a sentence. But diagramming sentences is mainly just a way to check yourself, but we'll do it an easier way. The developer will relocate the residence when they start to replace the flooring and install the cabinets. So that's another they. They and it are the biggest offenders, by the way. It is a problem too. Even though it is the correct pronoun in these examples, it is often used, you know, indefinitely. You can't figure what it's referring to. So this sentence, so who Your pronoun is they. What's the subject? What's the antecedent? Is it residence? That makes sense because it's the only plural. But then the third, but does that make sense that the residents are going to replace the flooring and install the cabinets? Yeah, that doesn't make sense. So the third one, the developer will relocate the residents when they start to replace the flooring. So from the sense of it, we can figure that the developer is really this the antecedent and the problem is the they. So you can mentally or on the page do something like this. You can make them bold to see what you're looking at so they stand out. You see, there's your choice of antecedents. It's got to be one of those. You can, and this is more like the diagramming the sentences. I think of pulling out the subject and the antecedent. So we can figure out, it's easier to see what that direct line should be. So you look at the you're not going to change developer. That is the right subject. But so you can see that the problem is they. Another way, you might notice as we go along, I'm a proponent of putting off a lot of these problems until later and not trying to solve them in your first draft. But everybody's mind works differently. I think maybe you don't want to lose your train of thought. You don't want to derail yourself by obsessing over what the right pronoun is here. So one way to avoid that is just like don't use pronouns when you write it. You can make them bold. You know, you can search for them. Developer will locate when the developer does. So you go back later and you can see it should be it or something else. So in the Centene example, you see the advantage of this. So the same thing, you pull out Centene and they mentally. You can, and it's easy to see that the right pronoun is it, obviously. Centene, a company is not a they, a senate is not a they, council is not a they, a nonprofit is not a they. They're all it, but it isn't always the greatest, you know, it is not a beautiful word. You know, you might, aesthetics come into this, we'll do more on later too. So if you do it the same way, don't use pronouns the first time, you know, don't be afraid to say Centene twice in a sentence. You can fix it. You know, we have search and replace. You know, we have search. You can put things in bold, take them out later. So you can see Centene, you've got to replace the second Centene. It should be it, but you can see that, again, that's just not aesthetically, that's not beautiful. So you decide, actually, instead of it, let's say the company. And you end up with a better solution. I think this skip it, not using pronouns, can almost be the most help when you've got a lot of people in a story. You know, think of a legislature story where you've got lots of names. And you know, I know the problem for the writer is it's all clear to you. You know exactly who you mean. When you say, after meeting with Jones, Spencer said she hadn't read the report. Well, you know that the she refers to Jones, but I don't know that. Nobody else can be sure of that. So do without the pronouns. After meeting with Jones, Spencer said Jones, and then go back and fix it. In the same way is same way you find that, decide that there's a better solution surely than it, you can decide there's a better solution than she. Spencer said the mayor hadn't read the report. So if you don't know, Jones is the mayor here. And you end up with a better solution. Any questions or objections on the pronouns? This part, you know, politicians say everything's personal. Now, this is personal for me. These are the false ranges. You get a sentence in a story like this, doesn't seem unreasonable, offers everything from math to geography. What does that mean? What's between math and geography? How does that scale work? You know, I don't know what you're talking about. What I want to know is if my kid can take Spanish. That is of no help to me. And that's one problem with false ranges. It's kind of lazy journalism. It's a shortcut to not do this, to not list what they teach. And I can see they don't teach Spanish, so I'm out of luck. But at least now I know. This most really raised its ugly head to me when I worked in California, and we would cover the county fair every year, and had this guy who sold, as you see here, deep fried everything from Twinkies to bacon wrapped pickles. These are real sentences from real stories. Then you think, fine, let's just get through today. Next day, our fair story would come in with this, right? Everything from candy bars to hamburgers. Another meaningless range. So it was all the fault of this guy. He goes up and down California with his food trailer all summer, working fairs. And everybody writes essentially the same story about him, about how gross it is, basically the food he sells. So the first one, these are real from real publications. The first one's got the false range, frog legs to Oreos. Second one doesn't do the false range. I'd say it's of more help to readers because maybe it doesn't all sound gross to me. Fried cheese balls is not that gross. I mean, there are people eat fried mozzarella sticks. You know, maybe it sounds, but one thing you can see, one thing that's kind of funny about false ranges and stories like this is obviously what we find the most interesting are frog legs and Oreos. They are both different publications, but they're both mentioned. And I have empathy for the reporter. This is what they're staring at when they go to cover it, write about the guy. It all looks pretty gross. Fried barbecue ribs. I think of these stories as warning people off this guy, not really being a public servant, not really sending him customers. One problem with the false range is that, and I know that we hear them everywhere. We hear them broadcasting especially, and you know, TV news or whatever. So they're kind of in the air, and it is hard to remember all the time that it's just nonsense talk. But also, it's promotional writing. You know, we've written you can get everything at Eckerd's from this to that. It's a commercial, right? On eBay, these are all real. These are from different places. You can get everything from books to cars at eBay, or from collector baseball cards to used cars. We're obviously fascinated by buying a car on eBay, and I'm not sure why, but we are. Or a especially bizarre false range at the bottom, the latest, and it doesn't even track, but the latest sneaker drops to rare vintage handbags. Neither of which I would have thought of, but that's a pretty false range. I mean, they're actually both, like, you'd find them pretty close to each other in a department store. I'm not sure what the range could be. The false ranges, I think, are especially ridiculous in activities. This is a real sentence, not from us. You can do everything from explore the ice age to make a pan flute. And it's also just a reminder that when in doubt, I mean, I think basically more of our stories should mention making a pan flute. That's just a great phrase. And I find the range is offensive, really, when you're talking about people, because I really don't know what they mean. This is from Rolling Stone's obituary of Gordon Lightfoot. It said his songs were covered by everyone from Bob Dylan, Neil Young, Elvis Presley, Johnny Cash, to Grateful Dead, Barbra Streisand, Jerry Lewis, Eric Clapton, John, and then replace him. When I mentioned this example to Brian Heffernan, he said, well, Elvis and Jerry Lee Lewis were contemporaries. How can that be a range? And I said, Yes, they are. They were contemporaries. Their careers started pretty much on the same day in the same room in the same building in December 1956, when this was the Million Dollar Quartet, when they got together. And when sometimes when I'm tempted to write something this dumb, I try to, maybe you do too, I try to picture myself walking into these four and saying, hi guys, we're going to record everybody from Johnny Cash to Jerry Lee Lewis. One kind of wonder what their reaction would be. What the hell? What am I? The ranges can have a legitimate use, usually chronological, sometimes simple to complex. So obviously Franklin Roosevelt to Joe Biden, that's a chronological order. Mostly kindergarten to grad school is a little bit of both. She taught herself to play everything from chopsticks to concertos. You know, you could justify that. I would argue it'd be even more helpful to me if it said, you know, she learned to teach herself chopsticks, ragtime, blues, jazz, show tunes, concertos. I'd still like to have a better idea of what that means. So the St. Louis has a history with false ranges that I use to shame people here about with. This, have you heard everything from Soup to Nuts? Yeah, it was a British expression for the order of service at a dinner party. You go to someone's home, the first thing they bring you is soup, the last thing they bring you is nuts, and everybody knows that. So when they bring the nuts, it's time to start thanking them and going home. And another way, soup, nuts. This is part of the shaming, is that the Three Stooges understood what this range meant, soup to nuts. So St. Louis for decades had a chain of hardware stores that was Home Depot before Home Depot. Huge hardware stores all over. And if you have been to the St. Louis airport, you'll notice that we only have a few styles of architecture in St. Louis that kind of work for everything. I had somebody who had trouble believing this isn't an old photo of the St. Louis airport. It's actually a Central hardware store. That's just, again, that's just what our buildings look like here. So Central Hardware had a slogan playing off everything from soup to nuts. Everything from scoop to nuts for years. And as you see, there was swag. There was even scoop to nuts swag, even on their name tags. Everything from scoop to nuts you could get. By the time it got to their credit cards, you didn't even need the everything. It just showed a scoop and nuts. And they were proud that they were proud of that. And this is a real obit from the guy who wrote the line. This was just, I think, 2021 he died. So his obit says he wrote scoop the nuts, by the way. And it was everywhere. It was on not just their toy trucks, but their real trucks. So the thing was, it was a joke. People knew that scoop the nuts, they knew it was a play on soup the nuts. But they also knew it wasn't a range, because you couldn't pick two things that have less daylight between them, right? The scoop is actually in the bin with the nuts. That's how you get the nuts at a Central Hardware store, or it's tied on a string next to the barrel. So it was a joke. Every time people said it was a joke, it basically means we got nothing. You know, we have two things you can get. So it's not to lament the state of Western civilization, but you know, some we used to kind of get the joke at times on false ranges, and you know, we can be that smug again. You know, they were actually skewering British dinner parties with a hardware store slogan is kind of fun. And this is my last section, and it's a little bit of a note, a reference to a nod to Holly's mention of the digital platforms. I first did this for writers who do a lot of how-to stories, and I suspect you don't, but I left this as the kind of example because it's just an easy way to grasp it and to visualize it. It's not because I kept the slides, I did not, unfortunately. So I told them, if you're going to do a how-to story, like how to pick a cell phone carrier or phone. So you start out with a lead, then you do a nut graph, you know, sort of the proposition graph. And then you go into the nuts and bolts of it. And you can do it with subheads. You may not like to outline your stories. And I understand that. I won't either. But we all had, or many of us have to fight the tendency to sort of turn everything into an essay. This does not work just for simple short how-to stories. But what I recommend is coming up with the steps you want people to follow, say, or in a more complex story, not steps, but elements of a story, a progression possibly, maybe a chronology. So what are the steps you're gonna have to go through to pick the best cell phone plan for you? Well, you can, you know, check their maps. You don't, you know, if you're not going to travel, no offense to the Ozarks people, but if you're not going to drive through the Ozarks, you don't really care if you've got coverage there. I'm sure the coverage is good in Nebraska and Des Moines. So compare prices, decide whether to keep your phone or get a new one, bundle with other features, check the perks, which are kind of the bonuses. So when you write these, I guess it's great if it comes out, you know, the first time in the right order or the best order, or the, you know, most logical order, but obviously it doesn't have to be. You can, you know, we can move these around. You can define a highlight and move pretty easily. So once you've got your subheads, you just start writing under each of them. And I know this seems pretty basic, but it's really a quick way to organize and crank out your story and to make sure you're not leaving anything out. And you know, I stare at those subheads a while to make sure I'm not leaving anything out. You just start filling in under each subhead. And because you're using subheads, the sections don't have to flow. You don't really have to lead one to another. You're just moved on. The subhead indicates you have just moved on to a new subject. Now, part of the advantage of this, this is a digital platform reference again. Since we've gone digital, which I know was quite a while ago, but there's always been a debate about what we lose in visualization. My students swore that they could visualize their story, even though they could only see a bit of it on a screen at a time. You know, that they could, you know, they grew up digitally, they thought, said that, you know, they could realize how far along they were at any point, you know, whether they were where they needed to be at that point in the story. Does anybody print out their stories, especially their long stories, anymore? Not really. Yeah. And I understand that. I don't argue with it. But there are, you know, there are people who like to see it that way. They can see how the story is coming along. And this is the Churchill bit. When Churchill wrote a book, his publisher wanted it trimmed. Churchill wouldn't work from galley proofs or a stack of paper. He wanted the, he didn't want it, he insisted the book be the chapter, I think it was a chapter at a time, be printed the way it was going to appear in the book with the right, the font that was going to be used, the number, right number of words on the page. And he would set it up, he would have it set up on counters like around the room, the way you know, a newspaper might have had banks with, you know, large pages being worked on around the room. And he would walk along the counters looking at the chapters. So he had this physical representation of how the story was moving along, whether it was moving quickly or not. And it wasn't just for length, it, you know, it was for flow. So I think I've seen a picture of that, but I couldn't find one. But I did find an example. So here's a page he was making edits to. And you can see it is a printed, it is printed as it would be in the book. It's justified right. And this was, in those days, was not done by, you know, clicking justified right on Word. And that is, of course, one thing people do sometimes, like, you know, especially if you're working in Word, you can look at all the pages at once, albeit small, to help you get an idea of how the story is moving along. So, and you can see at the top, it's got the folio lines in the page. It is what the page looks like, what it's going to look like. He wanted to see what the readers are going to see. And the page on the left is a letter he wrote to his publisher, updating him on changes. And he's saying that the changes he's made in this round are all small. They're just proof type changes. So the publisher does not have to reprint the whole thing again, which must have been a relief to him. And he says, and on the right, that's his updated table of contents, which you can see is in progress, handwritten numbers, changed to one of them. So this was a visualization. I think it's possible we've lost something in the loss of this visualization. I mean, surely you've read, not necessarily your own, but you've read a long story where you feel like it's a loop, you know, like, you know, you just keep scrolling down and it just keeps going. Did you read the Atlantic article about the CNN boss? That was kind of like that. That just kept going. So obviously it doesn't work for just how-tos. I like to pull the subheads out. You can pull the subheads out of the story. These are the subheads NPR used in its obit of Walter Cronkite. And this, I think, is a way to help visualize. If you look at, you know, you write your subheads like this, you can see, obviously you're not seeing body type, but you're getting an idea how the story's going to progress. And maybe you think, boy, the Vietnam thing I really should mention sooner. You know, you start thinking about how it flows logically. This is the order they use, but you might argue, I think it is, you might say, well, I might put V in, am I going to flow so that I explain how Cronkite established his credibility, why he was so trusted, and how did he use that? Well, he used it when he went to Vietnam and decided it was a lost cause. He called on that credibility, he used it up. But maybe you want to flip it. Maybe you want to say, when he went to Vietnam, he shocked LBJ and the nation by declaring Vietnam a lost cause. How could he do that? Well, he had this credibility. You might flip and do it that way. When you were otherwise finished, now you guys might not use subheads at all. You might not be used to using subheads.
Most of us do. I think most of us do.
Good. Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. Excellent. And sometimes people will only use like one or two. I'll tell you, if it's a long story, I encourage you, you know, I think you can lose a lot. I know some people don't like that it upsets the flow. I think the writer can make those work for us by not spending as much time on the flow and just jumping. I'm happy at times to jump sort of abruptly to the next chapter. Feels like the story is just moving right along, you know, when you do it that way. So that's excellent. So, and when we wrote in print, you know, subheads could be problematic too, because they were a design element, and maybe, you know, you couldn't really put one in a particular spot because it was the last line on the page, or the designer didn't want them for some reason. There were other elements in it, but we can, you know, we can pretty much use them wherever we want them. We can move them. We can add, you know, and I think we should take advantage of it. So the subhead, when you write the subheads, it's kind of like the pronoun thing. I myself don't spend a lot of time polishing those, at least the first time through. If one thing, you don't know if you're going to keep it. So when you finish it, if you decide you want to keep the subheads, then I'd go back and work on them all. I wouldn't, you know, personally don't try to get too fancy with them. You know, an Arkansas childhood or something, fine. But you go back and improve them then. Maybe and that's when you notice, like, you know, maybe they're all gerunds. You don't want to do that. You don't want to do growing up, going to school, building a career, you know, or something equally annoying. And you can take, maybe you want to take some of them out. You can do that at the end. Maybe you want to take all of them out. And you can do that because they've already done their work for you. They've helped you organize the story. And they've helped you visualize the story. So if you don't want to keep them, you don't have to keep them. If you do keep them, as I just said, it can help with those transitions by being a little bit abrupt. I don't know about you. I don't even like the word to talk about sort of transitions. I heard a writing coach once say that he works forever on his transitions, so his story will be too tough to trim. That's one of those things, like when the last journalist logs off, will be no comfort to anybody. You know,
I think that I love this idea of using subheads as a way to organize your thoughts. I had not really thought about that. I usually, I'm a big fan of subheads, but I tend to go in and put them in later. A lot of people will turn in copy without any subheads. Mm-hmm. And that's what I feel and see where they're needed. But I like, it's something to think about trying, new reporters there, to think about if you have a lot of material, think about that as a way to outline. I love that. Yeah. And another rule of thumb I heard was, because I do see a lot of long subheads, and I heard the rule of thumb is a 3-word subhead is probably, you know, where you want to be. You don't need to be the title of an essay. Like, you know, right. You really want that to be, you know, I'll never forget, I was at a training where they showed us, and this is like in the early 2000s. So we were talking a lot of people were new to reading news on a screen. And they're talking about, they showed us a heat map of where a reader's eyes go when they're reading a digital article. And it's an F shape, like F as in Frank. So that first chunk at the top is the first, like the top of the fold. So they're going to read that. But unless there's something to draw the eye down through the copy, it's going to turn into an F, so that people are not reading the stem of the F at all, because there's nothing to draw the eye down. So I really like the subhead for that as well. Like mm-hmm. you, Bob, sometimes I'll skip to the next subhead if I feel like the article is super long. And that's also why I love pull quotes, photos, data visualizations, all these things. Tell me, does everybody on here use Grove? I think that maybe Nebraska is the only one that doesn't use Grove. Ozarks, do you use the Grove CMS? That's a beautiful feature of that, because you can see, to your point, Bob, you can see side by side what the story is starting to look like. And that's a huge, you're right. It's really, when you don't have a sense of like the body or the shape of what you're dealing with, that can be really, really frustrating. I wanted to ask you, Bob, before we lose you, from the reporter perspective and the editor perspective, as a reporter writing their own work, before they turn that copy into their editor, what are some checklist things that they might have in mind to go through their copy one more time before they turn that in?
that round of self-editing. Obviously names and you know, search function is just a hero. You know, every time I see a name, I search for other references to it. I tell you, there is nothing more depressing when I suspect a name is spelled wrong to Google it and see the first entry that comes up is St. Louis Public Radio.
One of the things I have to give Bob kudos for, and this is something that we didn't catch. We had a story that involved real estate, and there is a difference, right, between a broker, an agent,
a realtor.
And I would have never thought to check that as a copy editor, but he did check it, and he found out we had it wrong. I mean, does the reader necessarily know that? Well, some people will know that. And just, right. It's also good for the reporter as well. And he checked it and we were able to fix that. And so these are some things that I want reporters to also keep in mind before they turn their copy in.
Yeah, the point you just made always occurs to me when we over-explain something. You know, we kind of, journalists, of course, we act like nobody understands math and science, so we explain it kind of slowly and carefully, which is going on with the Titanic thing now. And of course, plenty of our readers understand it just fine. You know, we have accountants and scientists reading it, you know, who know far more than we do. So yeah, that self-edit to run through, obviously names, this pronoun thing we talked about, it, you know, it is a big thing. You know, you can have, there are checklists that exist, you know, make sure your nut graph, you have a clear nut graph. It was sort of a joke in the Washington Post, because a lot of stories, they're still looking for the nut graph on a lot of stories. But you do need one. You do need a clear, you know, proposition.
What's your definition of a nut graph? Because I think a lot of radio people don't really understand that concept, or they think they do.
Oh, okay. Yes. So the nut graph is sort of like, one place when I worked in Detroit, we used to use these ad issue boxes on the front page, and that was sort of a nut graph. So, like, you know, we'd do a story and we'd put a little box that would clearly say, here's what the issue is in that story. You know, the problem is, like, St. Louis needs to replace its water mains because, you know, they're breaking, but, you know, there's no authority that, you know, nobody has the authority to raise rates or whatever, which is sort of something they're running into. So that's the issue. And it's great if that graph, like on the how-to, that second graph, and mention the, you know, visualization of like our stories on a web page too. So you've got that top section, you know, the lead, that's a bit of a graph. And the second graph is your sort of proposition, like what's this article gonna do for you without hitting people over the head with it. And it really needs to be a little bit forward looking. It doesn't just say, you know, three mains broke last week and left the city without water. It needs to say, like, there are some solutions, possible solutions, but no, you know, but each of them has drawbacks, or something that looks a little bit forward. And, you know, and then you go into it. And as you said, with the visualizing, I can picture that for the how-to. And also, I'm going to do the subhead thing for our station in a presentation on how to write feature obits. So if you think of the Cronkite one, and the format I like there is sort of a long first section, because the lead is that the person died, and we do not, by the way, go into a lot of details on that, but the person that died, what their importance was. The second or third graph could be a fresh quote, is excellent, like, He was the best ball player in St. Louis ever, or something. And several graphs about its sort of overall importance, or how this person changed things. And then into the subheads, which, like Cronkite, and a thing to find. Some people really don't like chronological, so you really try to resist like the first subhead being when they were born, you know, or whatever. But you think of that as a longer section, kind of about the person's importance, and then the details. And the details are all like how they got to this spot, how they got to be so important, or how they built this career. And you want those as clear as you can with the subheads right away. And there are checklists on the self-editing. I'll see if I've got one around.
I think we have one from Luke. Luke shared one that NPR has that we put in the chat. Does anybody have any specific questions? It could be about something we've talked about, or it can be a pet problem that you often have, or a question that you've heard answered ways that are not satisfactory to you.
I have a question about pronoun confusion. Mm-hmm. So is it okay then to sit for a company, which is an it, to mm-hmm. say something? Like, can't an it not say something?
Yeah, I think that might be a lost cause, even though I'm with you. But, you know, obviously it's better to say so-and-so of Centene said. You know, or, you know, it's certainly fine. I know some people use statement a lot because it so often is a statement. Some people places are pretty big on saying Centene said in a statement that, you know, which gets away from that.
Yeah. And so often now we get things that are not even like, we don't even get someone who's, you know, we can even say that who wrote it, like we have no idea. I think a company representative is a good one too, because we're not claiming it's an executive, we're not claiming it's a leader, we're not saying they're a Centene official, but it is someone from Centene. So we can say a representative if in doubt, you know. I think that could be, that's another pet peeve of mine. Bob's hit on some very good pet peeves of mine in this.
You know, and that brings up another one. The Twitterization of these statements, we get, I went on a rant about this recently, but you know, this nonsense that they write these from the mountaintop pontifications, and their companies especially, or organizations, that if it were a reporter at a press conference, you would never write down this nonsense and then type it into your story. But people grab it off Twitter or an emailed statement and put it in a story. So we're getting stuff like, because they all say about the same, we have no higher priority than the safety of our students. Don't use any of that crap. You know, just, you know, it's sort of reflexive. We need a company statement. There's a company statement. But yeah, don't help me fight that.
Hey, I have an exercise for you. I'll look at the headline I shared in the chat. This is a headline I got yesterday, which I changed. But tell me what meaning do you take from that headline when you read it? This is very much on point to what Bob was talking about with pronoun confusion. Can you see that, Bob?
I'm looking for it. I don't.
It says the feds are offering states the option.
Oh yeah, there it is.
To extend postpartum care for moms. Some are turning it down.
Right.
Like, what do you take from that when you read that, people?
I hear like FBI when I hear feds.
But other than, let's take out that part. But who is turning down the help? Who is turning down the option? The moms or the state?
It seems like it's the states, but it reads like it's the moms.
Exactly. Because that moms is right next to some are. So as Bob is saying, you know, when you have those words close together, yeah, and feds may not be the best either. It could have been the federal government or Washington, but this is, we also have character limitations on headlines. So when I saw that, I was like, wait, the moms are turning down extension of postpartum care? That sounds crazy. And then I read that and I was like, oh, right. It's not the moms, of course, it's the state. So, you know, and we don't even need moms in there because we know who has postpartum care. We know that people who give birth have postpartum issues. So we don't even need extra people in there. right? You just have the postpartum care. And so that was a very much an appropriate example of what Bob is talking about. And we are going to wrap up, but if anyone has any last questions, please go ahead and ask them. And know that this will be recorded and shared with everybody, as well as Bob's slides. So
let me just mention that if you do the subhead thing to organize your story, and someone asks you if you outline before you write, you can truthfully say no.
Or yes, depending on how you want.
Right. Either way, you say, I don't need to outline. I do the subhead thing. I don't need to outline. No, it's all in my head.
But that's a great tip that I'm going to try, because I had never thought about doing subheads first. So does anybody else have any questions? Before we go, there was someone else from the Ozarks who joined us. I think he just popped up. What's his name? Next to you, Gregory.
Yeah, this is Dylan Durrington, one of our summer helpers as well.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming, everybody from Nebraska to Springfield. We appreciate it. And Bob, thank you again for your time. This is great material, very helpful. And we will be using it immediately.
Excellent. Thanks, guys. Thanks for listening.
Thanks a lot. Take care.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.